Officers from the scientific squad believe the fire was started after an electrical fault in the refrigerator shortly before 8 this morning. It quickly spread, engulfing the fibro cottage in Gibbous Parade Lemon Tree Castle. Mrs. Beverly Broadbent and her 2-year-old son Andrew managed to flee from the burning home, but 4-year-old Jonathan was not so lucky. It appears that he was trapped in one of the bedrooms. Local fire brigade officers and police were quickly on the scene, but little could be done. The fire quickly destroyed the house and its entire contents. Later, Mr. Alan Hepplewhite, fire control officer for the Port Stephen Shire, spoke about the tragedy.
Our first fire unit on site, I mean, passage, indicated to me that there was every reason to believe that there was a youth inside and in fact may have been incinerated.
And that in fact was the case?
That was the case, yes, unfortunately.
Though still 2 weeks away from completion, the Newcastle Beach Pavilion was officially opened today. More than a year under construction, the new $1.1 million pavilion includes public dressing rooms, toilets, including one for the disabled, a kiosk, boat shed and surf club change rooms. But today's opening is the pavilion only in the theatre. That's expected to be officially opened during February. Meanwhile, Newcastle City Council expects the iconic pavilion to be completed by the new year.
Taxis. These are how many people made their way home on Friday and Saturday night following the introduction of random breath testing. But taxi operator Mr. Bruce Chisholm says he's not sure whether random breath testing was the cause of the 40% increase in taxi fares taken. He says it could just be the time of the year.
Each club or pub has its own way of coping with the new system. At the Civic Casbah Tavern, the licensee offers to phone a taxi free of charge for his customers. Some clubs have been announcing the location of the booze bus over their intercom systems. Officer in charge of the traffic department at Newcastle Police Station, Sergeant Stan Goffert.
At this present stage, we've heard that the clubs are putting over the intercom system of our locations around the Newcastle area, but at this stage I'd say that we will be having talks with them during the week.
Gave Zurbriggen, aged 19, a lead in the current World Cup standings, ahead of countryman Peter Mueller and Konradin Katherman. They didn't compete at Adelboden, and Zurbriggen now has 103 points, 11 ahead of Mueller and Katherman. Ingemar Stenmark, 4 times winner of this event, finished a surprising 7th, and last year's winner of the overall World Cup, Phil Maher of the United States, was way down the field in 11th spot. Challenger, who lost the title to the Japanese boxer in December 81. Both fighters threw leather from everywhere in the final stages of the fight. A few punches were telling, as both boys were very tired. Takashiki said after the fight that he knew he was ahead on points, but was not able to land good punches to stop Wan Yin. The presentation of the beautiful medal to Ian was made by the local manager of the United Permanent, Richard Drake, with Mr. Drake announcing at the same time that Ian will become one of 36 finalists of a gala evening at the Opera House on February the 20th to announce the winner. A cheque for $200 was also presented to Brian Marsden, secretary of the Newcastle Pistol Club, for the club's nomination. Ian's father, Colin, then explained how he became interested in shooting.
We've always been field shooters, and as they grew up, we all joined the pistol club and we shoot as a family.
The state title that he won, what actually comprised the state title?
Well, this was an open match for what they call a service match, and it's a 90-round match ranging from 50 metres back to 7 metres, a variety of positions, kneeling, standing, laying and so on. Extremely difficult match.
Colin, the particular type of shooting that Ian's doing, is that a Commonwealth Games sport?
It is a Commonwealth Games sport. This particular one, this particular service match, isn't. But he shoots all the other ISU matches and the Olympic matches and so forth.
This is the 11th year the school has been held, and its popularity is growing each year. In that time, more than 1,300 children have learned to sail under the direction of the Skippy Commodore, Kevin Buxton. For the small fee of $10, the youngsters learn the theory of sailing, as well as the basics of seamanship in small pelican boats. After a demonstration, it's into the water to put knowledge into practice. Four power boats are always on patrol to rescue the budding sailors if they get into difficulty. But as Kevin explains, safety is a top priority.
Well, I place a lot of importance on the safety aspect because so many people do go on the water. They don't know much about boats and particularly sailing, and they get in a lot of trouble their first day out on the water, and they put the boat away and that's the end of their sailing careers.
The young sailors come from as far away as Tamworth, Sydney, the Upper Hunter, and even two from Victoria. For many of the youngsters taking part in this week's sailing school, it could be the start of a long sailing career. What with Newcastle being blessed with both Lake Macquarie and Port Stephens. And who knows, in a few years, they may be guiding one of these down to Hobart. It's been 2 months since Percy was rescued from the Hunter River at Hexham. Local fisherman Scott Gollan found Percy with what looked like a bullet wound to his beak. The upper part had been blown apart.
It appeared to me that it had been shot off about that far on the top beak, and the bottom beak was broken on one side with a hole in the bag. So he had trouble even picking fish up.
Well, how did you catch him?
Well, we got some fish net, put it round him and sort of ushered him into the shallows. And couple of people, and we just sort of picked him up. We missed a few times, but he was that hungry he kept coming back.
After receiving the attention of Merriweather vet Graham Brown, he was ready to try his wings today and take to the wild again. A large crowd of friends were at the fisherman's co-op to see the big bird on his way. Percy took to the water, but his first attempt at flying failed miserably. Percy soon learned he had been away from his flock too long, but he eventually took off for a lap of honour of the harbour, much to the delight of the onlookers. The surgery required to make and refit the pelican's bill was first pioneered in America. Vet Graham Brown first had problems with the weight of the beak, but Newcastle people rallied around to help.
Well, it actually cost nothing at all, because everyone kindly donated their services, from Wickham Fiberglass, who constructed the bill, to a dentist who constructed that acrylic plate on the top of his bill, and to an orthopaedic surgeon who kindly mended that lower bill with some bone cement.
Sad to lose Percy?
Yes, we are, as a matter of fact. We got quite attached to him and became very, very tame.